So, ich hoffe, jeder hat einen Platz gefunden. Die Tür lassen wir mal offen für die, die vielleicht noch nachkommen. Herzlich willkommen heute hier in Herzogenaurach im Adidas Learning Campus, genauer gesagt in the Shed. We start in German.
Okay.
We switch to English later on. Das ist die letzte Woche in dem Corporate Learning 2.0 MOOC, die Abschlusswoche zu dem Case von Adidas. Das heißt, wir begrüßen mittlerweile auch schon 36 Leute in dem Livestream, die uns heute zuschauen. Und das werden sicher auch noch einige mehr werden. Ihr seht da oben auf dem Beamer, haben wir mal geworfen, die Kommentare, den Chat, der aus dem Livestream kommt. Das heißt, Leute aus dem Livestream können uns jetzt hier rein auch Fragen stellen. Und wenn wir die wahrnehmen, dann können wir die hoffentlich auch in das Gespräch mit einmoderieren. Wer möchte, kann auch gerne mit dieser Adobe Connect App, wer den MOOC verfolgt hat, sich dort mit anmelden und im Prinzip auch Fragen reinposten. Ihr könnt aber im Publikum gerne auch einfach Fragen stellen. Wir haben die Marina oder den Karl-Heinz mit einem Handmikrofon, also wer eine Frage hat, einfach kurz Handzeichen, dann würdet ihr das Mikrofon bekommen, sonst hören die Leute im Chat nämlich nichts und wir können euch dann mit der zweiten Kamera auch rauspicken, dann sieht man auch, wer spricht und dann hoffen wir, dass wir diese Offline-Online-Kombination ganz gut hinbekommen. Nachdem die Leute, die jetzt im MOOC dabei sind, ich weiß nicht, wer im Raum hat in den MOOC mitgemacht? Eins, zwei, ah doch, das sind doch recht viele, ein Drittel, okay. Aber es ist ja so, dass die Gruppe, die heute hier ist, eigentlich eine andere Gruppe ist, als die MOOC ist. Also es gibt eine Überlappung, das ist schon mal schön. Aber deswegen würde ich den Karl-Heinz ganz gern nach vorne bitten. Karl-Heinz, dass du kurz den Leuten im Stream mal erklärst, wer denn jetzt heute hier ist, warum nicht die 1600 Teilnehmer aus dem MOOC hier sind. Dann wäre es wahrscheinlich ein bisschen voll. Und wie es jetzt zu dem Termin heute hier kommt.
Ja, also erstmal, ich freue mich, dass wir mit der Corporate Learning Community von Hessen Metall heute hier bei Adidas sein dürfen. Und wir nutzen natürlich gleich den Livestream jetzt mitzuerleben, also den Abschluss der achten Woche des MOOCs. Und anschließend sind wir natürlich sehr interessiert an dem Modell von Adidas, wie Learning Campus denn funktioniert und wie es denn weitergeht. Also wir sind ja ganz fasziniert auch schon von dem Thema dieser Woche. Für uns ist, also für die meisten von uns ist ja der Learning Campus schon was so Besonderes und so Innovatives, aber wir merken, hier wird schon drüber nachgedacht, wie es denn weitergeht und an diesem Prozess ein Stückchen teilhaben zu dürfen, das freut uns sehr. Also hier ist die, sind etwa 35 Leute der Corporate Learning Community von Hessen Metall und wir freuen uns genauso wie alle draußen jetzt auf die Abschlussdiskussion der achten Woche.
Super, vielen Dank. Und damit würde ich jetzt auch auf Englisch umschalten, because Susan, she's Canadian.
And
she's
I am.
You're speaking German a little bit,
yeah.
And for those of you who have not been in the MOOC, perhaps we make a short recap. We started the week with a status quo, like where is the Learning Campus nowadays? What about the physical infrastructure here? What about the Learning Campus online as well? Mm-hmm. And perhaps, Susan, you start to give out a few words on the status quo, on your person, what's your role, and then we switch
sure.
to Christian and talk a little bit about the history, so everybody's on the same page here in the room.
Yep, sounds good. So thank you all for being here. My name is Susan Durkacz. I'm leading our global learning team, and yeah, happy to talk to you about the Learning Campus, where we've got to up to today, and then hopefully where we're going in the future. That's going to be really interesting. So the current status of Learning Campus. Learning Campus is an umbrella brand within Adidas Group, and our vision is that this is the future one-stop shop for all learning within the Adidas Group. Doesn't mean we, the learning team, control everything or manage everything, but in fact, everything, people, all our users and learners can find everything they want and need under this brand. So that's what we're working toward. Where are we now? So we have both a digital platform, and if you participated in the MOOC, you probably saw that demonstrated, with various apps that our learners across the globe can access. The Learning Campus digital platform is available right now to about 30,000 of our employees across the globe. So that's 30,000 of our approximately 53,000 people. It doesn't reach our employees who are working in our stores right now, but perhaps that's a future possibility. In addition to the digital learning opportunities, we have physical and in-person learning opportunities, and this is one of the first spaces that was built, thanks to Christian, under the brand of the Learning Campus. So what we aim to do is provide spaces that are just enable people to get together, to learn, to share, to discuss, to collaborate. And I think the Shed here is a perfect example of that. So what we've seen and learned is that it is really important to connect both the digital and the physical. I think our users want to have both of those. Maybe they're separate at some times, but often they're together to help people really make the most of their learning opportunities and to connect with all our employees across the globe. And this does heavily tie into our vision of a future workplace. So, you know, learning opportunities are an integral piece of that future workplace, and they're really just built and blended in there. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much. This was for those of you who were in the MOOC, the Monday, like the status quo. And then we created a podcast with Christian, like 1 hour audio. Who did listen to that podcast? Oh, also 10, 15. Nice. Very good. So Christian was in the project since the beginning, and perhaps a few words on your role during the project, also your role now, and how you experience the history of the Adidas Learning Campus and the story behind.
Yes, so short recap. I think it's a bit loud. A short recap of how that all happened. I think it started with actually our CEO, Herbert Heiner, surprising the organization by standing at an all-employee meeting and kind of in a side sentence mentioning that we will build a corporate university. And everybody's a bit shell-shocked and saying, damn, who should do that now? And that's where HR started putting a team together to really bring that to life. At that point, I was still heading up internal communications at Adidas, and our former head of HR asked me if I would be interested to join the newly formed learning team to also set up the strategy with a slightly different perspective. And we then formed a team of very diverse people from all over the brand, and we started sketching out a strategy for a new learning. Because the first thing, which especially we did in the beginning, Simon, is we did a lot of research with your help to look at what's out there. How do other organizations set up corporate learning? How do schools work? And what are best practice examples there? What didn't work? And then we came to a point where we said, wait, we would like to do things a bit differently, because we saw a lot of examples of, let's say, learning campus that kind of worked or almost worked or didn't work so well. So we really took two steps back and said, well, how does a human being work and learn? And we found out with this, I mean, 70-20-10 is one of the models used out there. And we found out that actually most of the studies and surveys show that how people or humans learn is very different from how corporate universities actually think their employees learn. And that's often a mismatch, especially as we know most people learn most by informal learning, by communication, by exchange. In all companies, most companies, approximately 98.5% of the budget is put into formal classroom, you have to attend top-down learning. And we know that's a mismatch, that doesn't work. So we set up a strategy, we worked out a strategy, we crowdsourced the strategy, actually. We had an idea of where we wanted to go, but then we said, wait, why don't we include our audience and our target groups? So we did a survey with the employees and asked the employees, how would you like to learn? What would you like to learn? We got a lot of great feedback there. And then we said, that wasn't bad, but let's take it a step further. Let's really do open source crowdsourcing. And we wrote an article for and put it on our Adidas Group blog on the internet, so outside. And we asked the whole world, we're working on a learning campus. How would you build that? How would you like to learn? We got a lot of fantastic responses there. And out of that, we built the strategy for the new way of learning.
Yes, and we tried to capture what the new way of learning is in a short infographic. And perhaps, Susan, in your words, new way of working came from the Adidas Group strategy, like non-political, collaborative, open working. Mm-hmm. New way of learning, in your words, what is it?
Yeah, I think the first piece is that working is learning and learning is working. And what does that really mean to us is that we, in fact, are learning every day from people all around us, all the time, whether we think we are or not. So part of our journey is actually helping our learners, our employees change their mindset to understand that, hey, in fact, there's all these great learning opportunities around you, from the colleague next to you or to a colleague around the globe. It's halfway across the globe. And how can we start to leverage all of these great opportunities? So really taking away or removing that mindset that learning happens formally at one time, one place, but in fact, there are opportunities everywhere, and encouraging people to make the most of them, partly by offering opportunities, you know, like this, or hearing a speaker in different locations, but also by offering digital platforms to make that connection. I think that's the big one for me.
Yep. Anything to add, Christian?
Well, I think I would just add that I think the in the center is really putting the employee in the center of everything we do, and not looking at it from a corporate structural hierarchical position. And this, for me, the key is openness. And openness doesn't stop in opening it up across the whole Adidas group. It means openness to everything, openness to Facebook, to YouTube, to Twitter, to everything that is out there, learning groups, over LinkedIn, connecting with people, things you learn privately on the weekend, bringing that in. Everything's allowed. I think in the old model, it was kind of, most people know that everybody learns every second, actually. That's just human. You cannot not learn. But what you learn on YouTube, on Facebook, it doesn't count internally. And this is something we wanted to legalize learning again.
Okay, I just pick up one question from the chat. If you have any questions so far, there's put the mic over there. I just grabbed that question from the chat. Lana Florian is asking, how big is the team that cares for digital learning at Adidas, and is it centralized or decentralized?
I think when we launched it, it was definitely centralized, and there was a team when we launched of about 15 people at a core. However, we had people across the globe who were also supporting this and interacting with users. So the current team who is working on the learning opportunities itself are about, I would say, between 30 and 40, and that includes people out in our regions. Not everyone is working at the same level of focus or putting all of their capacity to digital learning opportunities. So I would say that is kind of a core team of less than 10. But I mean, when we don't, no one purely focuses on the digital. So that's a really interesting question. I think there still is always connection to users and interaction with users, and often people who are designing digital learning interactions also have the responsibility for designing in-person interactions. So it's really a mix.
So it's not digital versus physical, it's always like blended or both?
That's what I see right now, and that's what I see our learners and users wanting. So it's not just one or the other.
Okay, so we switch over to the audience. Perhaps you say your name.
Okay, sure. Martina, I'm coming from Arcor. We are in the hotel business. Actually, I have two questions, if you allow them. Question number one is concerning the brand learning. How did you manage to get all the different people from the shops, from different departments, product marketing, etc., under one brand? So could you just briefly describe what you did? Because actually, I think this is a huge task. And this would be question number one. Question number two is, how is talent management linked to learning? So we are currently discussing this. I see it outside in different companies that learning and development and talent management is getting together. Could you just briefly describe how this works at Adidas?
Sure. And let me give some input to the first question. I would also ask Christian to give some input to that one, and then move on to the next one. And the brand learning and learning campus, and you ask a really good question. So do we have all learning right now branded and available through this one platform, let's call it? The answer is no. So this is a multi-year journey, I see, because in fact, we also came from a position where learning was, and still is, and always will be, spread across the organization. So we don't hold the only responsibility for learning. Lots of different parts of the business have their own learning initiatives. But what we are aiming to is to actually give our learners and users an experience where they feel, and this is what people ask for, they feel that all their learning is available in one place. It might not all look the same, but anyway, that's where we're going. And so that's what we're aiming for. brand learning. Do you have something to say about that?
Well, I mean, we do have one, it's a bit of both. On the one hand, yes, people are asking for to find everything on one place. On the other hand, we do want to actively include YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, so everything's out there, which we can never brand and never get under one. Internally, we also have a little trick, so to say, which is simply design. If you look at the logo of the learning campus, Dazzle Camouflage, this is something which we use exclusively for learning. And we've branded everything with this Dazzle from the very beginning, and now we can just have the square somewhere, for example, in the speaker series, if we have Pharrell there, or yesterday we had Run DMC there. Great. It's a brand ambassador. He speaks on stage, but we have it always connected to this Dazzle logo. So everybody intuitively, when they see this, they know there's something I can learn. So I think it's more the philosophy of bringing everything together and less bringing it together organizationally.
True. It's also philosophical. Yeah.
And then we had the second question, like the link to talent management.
Yeah, that's a really important question. And definitely learning is not a standalone activity. It's actually an ongoing discussion and how we develop our cross-talent HR team to figure out in the end, there's only one, one consideration is what does our consumer experience? What does our user, our learner experience? And again, this is something we're working on. So we do work closely with our talent management team. One thing we know, and we also hear from our learners and users is they would like to hear have a clear picture of what is their journey across the organization as they join, as they join their first onboarding session, as they develop specifically in their function. So that's something we're in the process of really crafting and trying to ensure that employees feel like, this is my journey. It's not just one journey fits all, but it's a personalized journey so that it makes sense for them.
Yeah. And maybe to be brutally honest, I think we must say that at the moment we have not connected that yet. Everybody knows that it belongs together, needs to be connected.
Yeah.
We've had a lot of change in leadership. So we just have a new head of talent who we're just onboarding, who's taking over. He's setting that up. We have a new head of HR. We developed a new people strategy, so it's all in the larger context of a new people strategy as well, where these leadership development paths, onboarding are a very essential part of the strategy. And I think the next step will be really to physically and to organizationally connect learning, development, leadership.
Right. And I actually don't differentiate between any of those. I think leadership is all about learning, and it might just be a specific learning targeted at a specific group of employees. So.
Not sure if every leader is so aware of that, but that's maybe a task for the learning campus.
That is absolutely what we need to continue talking about,
Okay, so I pick up another question from the chat. Like, Jeanette was asking, how many offline learning campuses are available at Adidas beside the shed? If we stay on the campus over here in Herzog, we have another one where we were in this morning, like the Elvis we talked about in the podcast as well. Perhaps you can say a few words about other places of learning over here. And then in the Global Week of Learning, we had events in other locations. And perhaps you spend a few words on how does the situation look like in Asia, in the Americas?
Well, I think this is the biggest facility which is only dedicated for learning. But on the other hand, we have lots of learning rooms and smaller facilities in almost every location we have. Often it's just a room which people use. On the other hand, I would extend this physical approach, which doesn't necessarily mean we need to have a building for learning, which again is this old silo thinking, because our approach is really that learning happens everywhere and people should be able to sit at their desk and watch a YouTube video and learn, that should be accepted and respected as well. So it's on purpose that we break up this perception learning needs to have a building, and if you go in there you learn, but you don't work. And on the other hand, if you're not in that building, you work and you don't learn. That's exactly the core why we said working is learning and learning is working, that we need to break up this different thinking of that it's two different things.
And what about places in other like countries or locations? Is there anything?
Yeah, we do. I mean, we have in Asia, we have a few rooms for that. It's more often we have rented location where we can't like build something there in the US as well. But again, this is the largest dedicated learning facility.
Yeah. And what I would add is, I mean, what's nice that we do have, as you see on the computer there, the brand that's always standing for Learning Campus, that Dazzle logo. So no matter how big or small or partial a space is for learning, people can recognize it because of that Dazzle logo. And even now we have different locations who are saying, hey, I want to brand it in this way, that way. So it's always ongoing, which is really nice to see that people are still so excited about it.
For those interested, outside there's a little poster or infographic explaining the Dazzle design and where it came from, what the history is.
And I'll speak about that this afternoon later in the second session as well. Yeah.
Okay, I have another question from the chat, and I think there's a question that was left from the Wednesday live session from Beate Klitsch. She's asking, are there certain reasons why e-learnings have been put on the LMS instead of the Learning Campus Online? So perhaps a few words on this. Separation, the Learning Campus Online part and e-learning.
Right. In fact, I mean, I wasn't part of that specific discussion, but in fact, e-learning, so I maybe just have to clarify the question. E-learning is available both on our Learning Campus Online and on our LMS. So, our Learning Campus Online, for those of you who know the difference, I'm not sure makes sense to everyone right here, is available to all our, as I mentioned, up to 30,000 employees who sit in our corporate offices globally. The LMS was not available to all of these people. So for that reason, we replicated that and put e-learning on
that. In terms of licenses or?
Exactly, But now we're going global with that, which is really exciting for 2016. So unless there's more to that question.
Okay, then there's another one about the language. Like we're talking English right now. You have a lot of different nationalities over here and also people coming from different cultural backgrounds. Yeah. The question is if there's one language for all the courses or if this differs in the locations. Is it English? Is it German?
I think we can talk about two things. And one is the digital offer. And certainly that's available in English. When we launched, it was all in English. But over the past year and a half now, we have translated most of our content to German, since we're here in Germany, also Russian and Chinese, because those are big populations in our organization. Do we have plans to do more? Yes, and that's just a resource issue and how we actually get it done, but it's entirely possible. As far as the in-person opportunities, every location has their own in-person opportunities. They might run from formal to informal, and of course they're available in local language. So as an example, we have heard from our Japanese colleagues that in fact about 80% of their team prefer to learn in Japanese, which is totally fine, and then the team there supports it. Yeah. Okay.
So any questions from the audience over here? Yeah, over there.
Hartmut Wilke from Deutsche Bahn. So I'd like to know how you come up with a portfolio, so the topics of your content, do you ask experts or you have internal experts, or you ask your employees what they would like to learn, or you ask the world?
Yeah, a few different ways. I'll start with that one. Of course, there's some very foundational content that we knew had to be there when we launched. So things like around communication, dealing with interpersonal relations, working with others. So that's very foundational and applies to many people's situations and needs. What we have done in the meantime is done a survey where we reached out to our users and asked them, hey, in addition to what's there, what would you like to see? We got some good responses from users, and this was open to anyone who uses Learning Campus across the globe. So that will now give us input to develop our new rounds of content. As well, there's always things going on in the business. So, for example, at the end of last year, beginning of this year, the topic of how to manage change was bubbling up, and it was really discussed widely across the business. Do we need more support here? So then we could quite easily put together what we call a learning kit, which draws on, and if you participated in the MOOC, you might have seen that, draws on both external resources as well as some internal processes, things we do internally to give people a picture of how they could better personally deal with change, and then as well how people leading change can better lead change initiatives. So there's always things coming from both the business and our users. I think where we can perhaps get more inspiration is from outside the organization as well. So yeah, anything to add there? Yeah.
There's one more question in the chat. Like Susanne is asking, do you experience any differences of engagement in self-directed learning among employees working in stores versus head office? I think the stores are not so much in the focus so far.
Yeah, that's true, but I can answer that question. So when we talk about Learning Campus, that the digital platform and the brand hasn't reached our stores yet, so that's an ongoing process, but we do have a separate program for retail stores under a brand called Shine. So that is both digital learning opportunities as well, where infrastructure permits, as well self-access learning opportunities and facilitated learning opportunities in stores. And I mean, every market has a slightly different delivery model there, different resources to support. But yeah, it's a similar similar way of approaching learning, offering people different ways to experience a topic, if that answers the question.
And I think it's also a natural transition to do something, then check it, and then adjust it. I find it extremely interesting, the discussion which is happening right now around MOOCs. Do MOOCs really make sense? There's such a high dropout rate. We experience the same thing in a way that, of course, you can't offer everything digital. People want the physical connection. People have specifically asked for more workshops and so on to complement that. And so I think it's always learning, adjusting, and not setting a strategy and pulling that through for the next 10 years.
Okay. So before we switch to the ideas, one last question from the chat. Do you use specific blended learning programs for senior leaders? I think this has been a question throughout the whole MOOC, the role of leadership in learning, on the one hand as enablers, like motivating people to learn, but also as learners in the end, because learning doesn't end like on a seniority level.
Right.
So what about that?
Yeah. I mean, I can talk about some programs we're running right now. I won't go into tons of detail, but yes, absolutely. Blended learning experiences are what we're offering. And I think for the future, and in fact, 2 days ago, I committed to this, we will not have a program that is not any kind of blended learning opportunity. So we have a fantastic platform with which to reach people, for people to start collaborating and contributing to discussions. So if there's any program for any level in the organization, I would say we will incorporate digital learning opportunities there. Of course, as Christian just said, people also want to have in-person opportunities. And the question was specifically,
if there's any special blended approach for senior leaders?
I would say it's not a special approach only for them. It's not a different approach only for them. What we do know and hear is that, like many of us, our leaders don't have so much time to come out of their job and attend sessions where they really need to, basically cut off contact. What we have been asked for by many leaders is, can you give me sort of a short burst of learning? And whether it's just a customizable place to find what they're interested in, that's something we're actively exploring. Or we'll probably go more in the direction of streaming or bringing in some videos that are targeted specifically at more senior members of our organization to help them solve their issues. So that is a target audience for us.
Yeah. I mean, we also offer specific things for leaders, like leadership journey and so on, for teams coming together to take on new leadership roles. And I would also say beyond that, there are so many other opportunities for leaders which are used by leaders to learn. Like we have a lot of leaders on stage on the speaker series. Where they present what are they working on, what are their thoughts, what's the strategy, and then they learn from the reaction of the audience. Speaker Series is kind of like our internal TED Talk with open for everybody. So that's one. And another example of learning is reverse mentoring, for example. That's I talked to the senior leadership of Global Operations a few months ago and told them about the mega trends, risks and opportunities, generation change and so on. And they came back to me a week later and said they all decided that every single one of them has to get a mentee in a reverse mentoring relationship so that they give their experience and guidance to the young people, but also that in a trusted environment, our leaders can finally ask, what is this funny internet and Facebook thing? And could you please explain Twitter to me?
Okay, just because there's one very interesting question in the chat, I want to pick that up from Florian Lana. He's asking that in the week of the MOOC, we talked about learning at Adidas is holistic. And I think we're here in or close to Nuremberg. Perhaps one of you might know the Nürnberger Trichter. Like there's a teacher transferring knowledge and it's implemented in the brains of the people. So I think that's not holistic. Perhaps you can, with the infographic and the holistic knowledge cycle, explain, Florian, what the idea behind the holistic learning approach is and also what innovation perhaps might play for a role in learning.
Yeah.
Well, we can have the focus on the infographic.
Right.
And the
this is the this knowledge circle down there. And we said normally most organizations in learning, they focus on this yellow arrow. So learning, that's us, that's our responsibility. Everything else, we're not responsible. We said that's only part of the picture, and we have to really look at the whole holistic cycle where we say innovation, the creation of new belongs there as well. That's why we experiment with crowdsourcing, inspired by the learning kits actually were inspired by the way MOOCs are built up. And this is the way we built our learning kits then later on. And we're also changing that. So innovation has a very heavy part. Then, of course, learning, which is knowledge acquisition. And the last part, knowledge management, which is the identification of relevant knowledge. And then how do we retain and transfer this knowledge as well? So I must say this is a point where we still need to do more. We have some things in place, and one of the things, for example, is also our social intranet, Alive, which is like a Facebook for business, where everybody exchanges information, chats, finds people, and so on. This is a huge, active, and modern learning platform as well. Mm-hmm. So that's what we mean with holistic, not excluding anything, being staying curious and playful.
So I think when we entered the second half of the hour, we switched to the idea contest. We had the second half of the week. We ran an idea contest. The question was, we have around, I think, 1,500 unique users per month on the Learning Campus Online. A lot of people running through workshops and courses over here and in other locations. And we asked, like, what can we do to push that, like have more active learners, so to say. And we gathered until yesterday, 4 p.m., around 34 ideas that people gave us, and this morning we sat together and we condensed like a top 10, so to say, and we want to go through the places 10 to 4 in a quite quick manner and then focus a little bit on the top 3 that we have. And we are lucky since Martin Geisenheimer, he was one amongst the top 10. And perhaps if Karl-Heinz with the mic can bring the mic to Martin, he can explain a second idea, like his idea later on. Well, I start, there's no ranking in the places 10 to 4. One idea was to run a real X MOOC, like to do the same what we did. We had a C MOOC, a constructivist MOOC, but the idea was to run an X MOOC inside the Adidas group. What do you say about that idea?
Great idea. I think that's something we're exploring a little bit, and how we actually have the I guess the technology to support it is one thing, but it's not the only thing. So we've had some tries in that direction where we had some really good participation offering virtual learning experiences across the globe. And that was really cool, having people engage with, you know, leaders based in different locations, even different leaders at the same time speaking about topics, reaching out to a global audience. So I think that direction is absolutely what we see working and we know our employees are interested in. So, yeah.
Yeah, it's something I think we considered from the very beginning. We're very much inspired by MOOCs back then when I met Daphne Koller, TED, and so on. I thought, brilliant, let's use that as a basis for the Learning Campus. And I think there are so many great working examples out there, like the colleagues at SAP with OpenSAP. Brilliant what they do, really fantastic, huge opportunity. We're already in discussions to maybe do something together, maybe. So let's look at that, but definitely, yes, great idea.
We had, you mentioned SAP, we had the idea from Thomas Jenewein to motivate people through gamification. Mm-hmm. I think this is a big buzzword and there are a lot of approaches thinkable. Do you have any plans or why do you rate it amongst the top 10?
Yeah. And I think that's something we're really actively exploring as well. Not so much gamification, but how people are motivated and incentivized and then recognized for what they're doing in the learning area. It's not just also what they're consuming, but what they're contributing to the organization and to their colleagues' learning. So that's something we'd like to give more recognition, I would say, is the word we want to see there. And we've also heard that from our employees that, they would like to let people know what they've done in the learning area. So that's one good way to do it.
Yeah, big fan. I mean, no discussion there because I think everybody who has children and sees how fast they learn languages or navigating the world through learning and through playing, we actually know how important play is and how efficient play is. So I think that's a very huge component of efficient learning.
By the way, the first idea with the MOOCs was Clemens Link, just to give the credits to him. So now I think Martin has the mic in the back. You had quite a lot of ideas. The one that we picked out was to use a quiz app and playing a quiz duel as a learning approach.
Right. Yeah. Okay. I'm Martin from Swisscom, a telecom provider from Switzerland. We have a similar problem that you have. We spend a lot of time and energy in these 10%. And we realized that there's not much traffic with people who should learn formally in these 10%. And so we now are planning to or are testing the approach to use this QuizDuel app. All our employees, especially young people, do these QuizDuels every free second or every free minute with each other, but not with our issues, not with our topics. So now we are providing some questions in a target group. We want to test it to find out if this would work as well with these topics. And the idea is, of course, nobody can answer any question in these duels. And so we kind of generate a virtual moment of need. They cannot answer the question or they fail against their challengee, and so they see, oops, maybe I should try to learn something about this topic. And we want to provide a link to this learning module exactly for this topic as well. So in this virtual moment of need, they can immediately, because next hour they might have forgotten it already, they can immediately start this learning nugget. So I'm not sure if it works, but we are going to try this.
Yeah, I mean, sounds great. We really like the idea. I would say one thing that I think we also hope helps people and engages them is to see exactly as you've described. So where do they need to learn? And if it's through something more fun and a game they're playing with their friends, then that's one way for sure. Yeah.
It's also kind of a gamification approach to learning.
Absolutely, yeah.
Then we had an idea coming from Herbert Schmidt, and he called his idea the 1,000 wishes box. Like have a virtual box where learners can put their wishes, like their desires. How do they want to learn? What do they want to learn? Mm-hmm. What do you think about that idea?
Yeah, I think it's so important to ask the learners what they want to learn. So sure, there's always going to be something that an organization needs to let people know about. But I think we also have to trust our employees that they know what they want to learn. And even I would prefer to give them more trust and recognize that they know what they need. However that works, I think it's really important. We, as I mentioned before, have surveyed users. And I would say one thing is we know we need to connect with more users. So if there was more of an ongoing process there where people could always give a suggestion or let us know what they need, then that would also help us. So fantastic idea. Yeah.
Yeah. And I think also, I mean, as I said before, we've tried to integrate our users, employees from the very, very beginning in even building the learning campus and including the internet, actually including everybody who wants to be included. But with this, maybe it's an interpretation of mine as well, but what I see here as a potential is to have it more in real time. Because yes, we do a lot of surveys, we do a lot of things, but first of all, not everybody participates in a survey. Mm-hmm. And then we do a survey, and then the next year or two, we don't do a survey again because we just did one. If we really switch to a more real-time engagement check-in with employees where they can new employees can, if they just join, miss the survey, too bad, wait 2 years, give your feedback, that doesn't work.
So it's more a continuous improvement approach to learning with right. very user-centered yeah. design yeah. philosophy.
Yeah.
Okay, so I just skipped through the other in the top 10, so we have enough time for the top 3. Like we had the Adidas Bound, it was a sort of a geocaching approach to learning, have an educache, let people explore it like pathfinders. Mm-hmm. This was one idea coming from Christine Knie-Riemann. Then we had the idea of the campus runners, like creating shoes with the DESL design, which is an interesting idea, and give that to learners as a sort of a price.
Which we have, DESL shoes.
Just show us.
No, not on, but we had them already in the past, so mm-hmm. yeah.
Then there was the idea to have focus workshops by Sibylle Dietrich-Horenburg. It's like involving more the departments and the leaders of the learners, not just send an individual from the department to a course, but the whole group, which I think is an interesting thing. And I think this was the 7. Yes. Mm-hmm. You decided to give sort of an extra prize or extra mentioning. Because it was not directly focused on improving the rate of active learners, but it was an interesting approach to have more ideas in the learning campus itself. And it was the idea of having job rotations of people from the Adidas Learning Campus with other corporate universities. Let them be at another company and see how they have their learning approach and change, for example, a month or two or half a year. Mm-hmm. Do you think this is realistic?
Is it, I think it's a fantastic idea. Is it realistic? I think we have to find ways to make this work. So, we often have chances to meet for a day like this, to exchange ideas. That's really great. People sometimes keep in touch after that, but it usually drops off. But I think being fully immersed in a new environment and having new people come in and sort of look at what we're doing, is really helpful. So, I thought, that's why that idea got an honorable mention, just because it's such a good one. Yeah.
Okay. So this is our extra prize, and then in the top 3, we had one idea. It was called the virtual round table. And as I interpreted, the idea is to have sort of a lunch and learn event, like meeting and having a topic, learning together, but not physically, but virtually.
Hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I thought this was a great idea. In fact, we do have in various locations have different types of lunch and learn events. We have an event here called Lunch Roulette. Won't go into detail, but that brings people together to just chat in person on specific topics. But the virtual roundtable is really hopefully giving people an opportunity to connect with people they normally wouldn't have connected. And just leveraging that social learning experience, and hopefully, you don't need to be right next to someone to make that happen.
Mm, yeah, I mean, as Susan mentioned, we have this lunch roulette where we also randomly mix people. It's a bit like blind dating to getting to know people. This is where knowledge transfer actually happens. And also in the future workplace, it's a lot about creating places that enable creative collisions. So to bring people together which normally wouldn't be together, that's like the old smoker's corner, for example, that was a great place of learning always because there people met who weren't from the same department. Didn't kind of work with the Apple idea later on, but different topic. Yes, great idea.
Yeah. What I really liked about that specific suggestion was that you could join, but if you couldn't join, it would be recorded and then accessed anytime in the future. So that was for me a real value add there.
So how could this look like technically? Would this be a Lync session or a Skype session or?
Something like that. Yeah. Yeah. I think that's something we will explore. So, yeah.
Okay. Then we had the second idea in the top three. It was called push through going public. And I think the basic idea was that a lot of the learning content, which is now public or open inside the Adidas group, could be open to the general public as well. And perhaps there could also be ideas or courses created from the outside for Adidas that can be used inside the Adidas group.
Yeah. I love this idea. If you attended our MOOC or have been connected with Adidas, you know that one of our strategic choices is called open source. And it's where we are looking outside the organization to basically collaborate and co-create things. And so, yeah, absolutely. We're doing it internally. Why not do it with our employees? Why not do it with our partners and anyone interested? So it was a great idea.
Yeah.
Open source, I think, is a term we know from the software industry. And I think all these open like terms like open innovation, open content, open science emerge from that. Do you have a clear picture of what open source does mean for the Adidas group? Yeah.
No, because that's the core of open source. If we knew, we wouldn't have to do open source. So I think it would be contradictory to say we do open source and know exactly what will come out. So I think it's brilliant and really brave that our leadership in Adidas, we have open source as part of our business strategy. Without exactly knowing what that is and what that means for us. Of course, it means one thing. Means change and transformation, and I think that's important because that change and transformation needs learning, and I think that's to that everything's connected again.
I think that's also not widely discussed in the educational community yet. I think 20 years of experience in open source, it's like 30 years in experience in open source scene, so to say, and what this means for business models and for how does this work?
I think. Yeah. But I mean, the funny thing is that, even all the conservative business, they always use Google and Airbnb and all the successful open source examples as great shining examples how things should be done, but you shouldn't try that inside. So that's this contradiction, and I think this is exactly where we have to kind of break open the minds to say, guys, if you all admire Google and what they do and open source software, you all use that, but internally it's kind of the devil, where don't you dare mention that, and we really have to start living that, because that is the huge opportunity.
You mean it's not enough if the board travels just once to Silicon Valley
and comes back with a hoodie and a beard, right?
Okay, then our number one was like a combination of idea 33 and 34 by Martina Göring and Stephanie Steinemann, and they called their ideas Learning Marathon and Learning Olympics. What about that idea?
Yeah. Well, first of all, I love the idea. I liked any idea that brought in sports. So that's something that if you saw the Learning Campus through the MOOC this week, you might have said, where is the sports and athletics piece of it? So that's something that I think we can really leverage because, without going into so much detail again, excelling in any kind of sports or athletics is all about learning and doing it every day and practicing. And that is really what the kind of mindset we're trying to instill across our organization. So thank you for that, for linking that as well. It's, I think, going back to that gamification and user incentives topic where, we know that people are often motivated by a challenge. So when people can work towards something and achieve something and then say, hey, this is what I achieved, hopefully that is just adding to their learning experience.
Yeah. I think what we said in this morning was also like what we had in the Global Week of Learning, like one condensed part in time where everything was focused in learning. If that would repeat like every 4 or 2 years, would be a very good good thing to spread the idea of open learning.
Absolutely. And what that's my favorite idea in that, to be honest, because I think what's brilliant in here is not only the sports analogy. Sure, we love that. Our logo, our slogan going forward with the new business strategy is sports has the power to change lives. So obviously, great connection here. But what I really like about that, if you think about it, it really what the Olympic Games or the Learning Olympics would do is to connect the individual learning with team learning. And I think that is brilliant because this connection, often it's either or, either it's individual learning or it's you do something in a group, in a workshop. But I think this has the potential to bring both together in form of Olympic learning games.
Okay. So these are the top three. Thanks to all the contributors, so to say. I just forgot to say that the push to going public idea was created by Joe Meyer. So we have like 11 minutes to go, and this means that we have a little room for questions, if there are still open questions from the chat on the one side. I saw that the learning group Stuttgart was already cheering, if they want to go through the weekend. Are there any open questions like over there? And Martina, Joachim, he's a colleague of Martina. She says she's very happy about being amongst the winners.
Yeah, and another Martina. Martina again. The question concerning the sustainability of your learning activities. I was here in 2012. You already mentioned you had some changes in the board. How would you evaluate the necessity that someone in the board, someone in the management team is really, keeping the thing alive, keeping it in the focus? What's your experience there? And we have all these changes. How are you keeping the fire alive? Is it a budget question or is it a passion question? Maybe you could just let us know something about that.
Sure.
How you keep the fire burning.
Sure. I think multiple ways, and it needs attention, so it won't just burn on its own. Actually, so the dean of our learning campus is Robin Stocker, our CFO, part of the board, and actually coincidentally just came from a meeting with him today where we talked about, you know, what's going on with learning campus. And he said, absolutely. I'm still convinced. He was convinced, you know, 2-3 years ago when we started this journey. He said, I'm still convinced this is what our organization needs, and we need to even push it more, you know, so let's figure out how to create greater impact and engage more employees, I think. And that was the question of this MOOC. How do we really engage our employees? So we have, it's fantastic, and I thank him for that. We have that buy-in at that level. I think now it's a matter of, spreading this passion across the organization. So great that one leader and one very senior leader is behind us, but you know, do we have other leaders who are also willing to take that to their teams and push it? So I would say that's a challenge, really, really engaging at that level. But then it comes from across the organization. So it's not just leaders, but it's, you know, employees who are our learners who are impacted are also the ones who will drive this forward.
I mean, we have a lot of leaders, including board members, who all participate in the speaker series, who are willing to go on, who are happy to love to go on stage and share and learn as well. So it depends. I wouldn't just limit it to like the learning campus online. If we look at it
absolutely.
There, there's a good engagement. But yes, could be more. Could always be more.
Mm-hmm. There's another one question in the back.
Well, I'm Michael. I'm coming from Amadeus Germany, which is a big IT company in travel and airline industry. And coming with the car today, I was listening to your podcast. I was very impressed what you're doing. But what I was wondering all the time, what do we do, the ones who come from more, let's say, complex content? We have to deliver IT trainings, some of them boring, 5 days, 10 days, some of them with certificates and so on. And I'm always thinking, how can I pick ideas from you? How can I implement them in our programs? Mm-hmm. Do you have similar
sure, we have that challenge. So not everything is going to be condensed into, you know, a 30-minute learning opportunity, for sure. So we still have project management trainings. We still have IT trainings. Not that there's anything boring about those. But, I mean, they have to be delivered in a certain way. I think what we... If I could just, I know you have lots of ideas here, but I think what we can do is, what we're actively exploring now, is creating learning communities around specific topics. So if we have, say, a project management training, and sure, there's certification and people have to prove that they have achieved that, but then how can they continue to leverage what they learned and also build their expertise and share it with others? So what we would like to develop is a space, and it happens anyway, so it happens without our involvement, but can we, this is what we're asking ourselves in learning, can we offer a platform and maybe digital, maybe not, but to connect people on specific topics. So it's not just, you know, those 5-10 days they spent getting certified, but then what are they doing to continue their learning after that? That's one thing.
And I think if you're familiar with the TED Talks, I think the amazing thing about TED is that you can, there are topics like statistics where I automatically think, ooh, boring, really bad. And then there's a speaker there who in 20 minutes shows you that statistics can be a brilliant, fun, engaging, and important thing. So I think it's a lot about how to transport that, how to package that, make it fun and engaging. If it's not fun and engaging, I think the learning organization is doing something wrong. And if you're not convinced yourself, if you have somebody who's like, oh, I'm doing that job for 30 years, I can't stand that, now I have to tell the young people and kind of, there's no enthusiasm there. Park him somewhere in the cellars. Get somebody who really loves his job, loves what he's doing, and get him involved in the learning process. Use gamification. Experiment with things. And I think it's also a matter of packaging, because we all know if we have like these workshops where it's like 3 days, starting at 8:30, quick breakfast, and it goes until 6, that doesn't work. That's always a pain in the neck. If you package that in smaller units, do some sports in between, go outside, take a walk and do a unit outside, make it, you know, interesting, different. And it's not the fault of the learners if they start falling asleep. It's always badly set up.
I think there's also one citation I picked from when we went to Bonn to this Leonardo Corporate Learning event. There was one guy who focused on gamification. Mm-hmm. He said, if your learning journey would be a game, would you play it or not?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right.
I think this is the basic question. Mm-hmm. If you have a 5-day course on a not so interesting topic, mm-hmm. it's like a not so interesting game. People won't like play it.
And maybe just the last word on TED. If you look at TED or even YouTube and so on, almost to every single topic, you could find brilliant videos from speakers who are inspiring, who are fantastic. Just use them. Steal with pride. But what a lot of organizations do is they say, we have this topic, we have to do it ourselves. And then they do something with lots of money, which is out there much better for free. They repeat that in a very bad way for a lot of money. Complete waste of oxygen.
Yeah. Right, I think there are still so many open questions, but we almost reached the end of this hour, and we have some things to announce. We will try to answer the questions that are open in the chat and also here afterwards. I would like to give a big thank you to you as Adidas Group, as representatives for us, as MOOC organizers for being here today. Thank you very much. And then I switch back to German. And ich möchte gerne Karl-Heinz nochmal auf die Bühne bitten, in seiner Rolle auch als CLA, Corporate Learning Association Mitglied, die Organisatoren dieses MOOCs. Wie geht's denn jetzt weiter nach dem MOOC? Wir haben noch 3-4 Minuten Zeit. Was ist angedacht aus unserer Sicht?
Ja, zunächst Corporate Learning Alliance, eine Association gibt's auch, aber das hat mit uns nichts zu tun. Wir freuen uns, dass jetzt die 8 Wochen so gut abgelaufen sind. Wir haben jetzt insgesamt 1.556 Teilnehmer heute gehabt in dem MOOC, was ich schon ganz erstaunlich finde. Wir alle hatten gar nicht mit ganz so viel gerechnet am Anfang, aber die Zahl ist immer weiter angestiegen und es ist ja auch ein Zeichen dafür, dass sich rumgesprochen hat, dass es sich wohl lohnt, in diesem MOOC mitzumachen. Aber nicht bloß die Teilnehmerzahl war interessant, sondern war auch interessant, wie viel auch wirklich ganz wertvolle Beiträge da kamen. Also man hat ja sonst immer so Sorge, dass da so Dinge kommen, wo man sagt, müsste man eigentlich nicht lesen. Aber hier habe ich den Eindruck, 99% aller Beiträge waren wirklich interessant und öffneten praktisch so die Gedanken zu den Themen, die so angerissen wurden und gaben auch ganz viel neue Impulse.
Und ich meine, 33 super Ideen allein hier für uns, das ist schon mal wirklich wow, das ist echt Respekt.
Genau, da möchte ich auch nochmal darauf hinweisen, wenn man sich diesen MOOC mal ansieht, es war ja eigentlich eine Lernveranstaltung, aber in diesem ganzen MOOC gab es nicht einen einzigen, der irgendwo sagte, ich weiß, wo es lang geht und ich werde es den anderen jetzt mal erzählen, wie wir es ja oftmals in unseren Lernsettings machen, sondern wir haben hier uns alle gemeinsam Fragen gestellt und haben gemeinsam Antworten gesucht. Und was ich auch faszinierend finde, jetzt haben alle gelernt. Also auch die 8 Wochen gestaltenden Unternehmen, wie ihr jetzt bei Adidas, nehmen aus den Rückmeldungen von den Teilnehmern auch was mit, was bei unseren normalen Lernsettings ja auch nicht so ist. Normalerweise verteilt man sein Wissen und damit war es das dann. Ne? Insofern finde ich dieses Experiment, was wir als Experiment angelegt haben, schon mal ganz faszinierend, dass hier die Learning, die Corporate Learning Professionals selber in so einem Prozess mal sehr viel voneinander mitnehmen konnten. Ja, wie geht's weiter? Die Corporate Learning Alliance hat dies Jahr als ihr erstes großes Projekt mal angefangen und wir freuen uns jetzt, dass es gut abgelaufen ist. Wir müssen jetzt erstmal auswerten, was denn alles passiert ist. Sie können sich vorstellen, das war natürlich für uns alle ganz schön anstrengend. Jeder von uns hat ja auch die Patenschaft von einer Woche übernommen. Simon Dückert war der Pate jetzt hier für diese Adidas-Woche und die anderen Corporate Learning Alliance-Mitglieder haben sich die anderen Unternehmen ja vorgenommen. Wir würden ganz gern wissen, was gibt's denn für Vorschläge? Denn wir haben jetzt eine riesen Community, die sich alle mit Lernen beschäftigen. Und wir würden da ganz gern genauso vorgehen wie Adidas. Wir fragen die Community, was sind eigentlich die nächsten Themen, mit denen wir uns vielleicht gemeinsam wieder beschäftigen sollten. Also insofern, da werden wir noch eine Mail schreiben, wo man das auf der Plattform dann die Ideen dann unterbringen kann.
Also es wird am Montag auf jeden Fall nochmal eine E-Mail rausgehen. Die Moin-Plattform, auf der der MOOC stattgefunden hat, die wird jetzt einige Wochen auch noch offen sein. Wir werden gucken, welche der Videos und Materialien wir irgendwo hinsichern können, dass die im Nachgang noch verfügbar sein werden. Das ist mal der eine Punkt. Dort gibt's einen Evaluationsfragebogen. Das ist immer so ein bisschen trocken und staubig, weiß ich. Das wäre aber ganz schön, weil wir eine kleine wissenschaftliche Begleitung haben. Die Claudia Bremer wertet den, glaube ich, dann aus. Und das wäre ganz schön, wenn ihr uns darüber ein Feedback gibt. Und dort gibt es eben auch nochmal ein Ideenforum. Was könnt ihr euch vorstellen? Was wäre wünschenswert, dass wir als CLA im nächsten Jahr machen? Also da würden wir einfach Anfang der Woche nochmal eine E-Mail verschicken mit den Infos. Bis dahin werden wir auch wissen, wie lange die Inhalte auf der Moin-Plattform noch da sind, das weiß ich jetzt aus dem Kopf. Weißt du schon?
Ja, die Inhalte stehen permanent zur Verfügung. Also gibt überhaupt kein Endedatum. Es soll wirklich so als Open Educational Resources im Netz stehen. Wir werden allerdings die Foren so 2 Wochen nach dem MOOC schließen. Der Grund ist, wir müssten sonst jeden Tag immer gucken, ob da irgendwelche rechtswidrigen Dinge gepostet werden. Und das können wir uns jetzt nicht dauerhaft leisten. Also schreiben kann man noch 2 Wochen lang und danach kann man nur noch lesen. Aber das steht dann für alle dauerhaft zur Verfügung.
Genau. Und für die, die noch im MOOC nicht drin waren, es gibt eine Facebook-Gruppe, Corporate Learning MOOC heißt die im Moment. Die werden wir in Corporate Learning 2.0 einfach umbenennen. Und die wird dann auch dauerhaft für die Interaktion offen bleiben. Da sind im Moment so gut 350 Leute, glaube ich, drin. Also wer sozusagen nicht nur die Inhalte haben will, sondern im Diskurs bleiben will, kann gerne auch in die Facebook-Gruppe mit reinkommen.
Ja, und weiteres kann man natürlich auch auf dem Blog der CLA, den Co-Learn-All-Blog, so nennt er sich, aber die Adressdaten stehen alle auch auf der Moin-Plattform. Dort kann man immer erfahren, was bei uns weiter gedacht wird und weiter dran ist. Aber lass mich nochmal auf das Thema Community zurückkommen. Wir haben ja diesen MOOC als C-MOOC gestaltet und C steht für Konnektivismus. George Siemens hat ja gesagt, Lernen ist die Fähigkeit, in einem Netzwerk Verbindung zu schaffen. Das Netzwerk mit über 1600 Leuten ist jetzt geschaffen. Ich kann also allen nur empfehlen, jetzt Verbindungen wachzuhalten, zu pflegen, vielleicht sogar neue noch zu knüpfen. Also pflegen Sie alle Ihre sozialen Kontakte über die sozialen Medien, also auf Google+, auf Xing, auf LinkedIn.
Wie Christian schreibt, ja, für alle Fragen und Vernetzung, LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook und so weiter.
Genau, Ja. Wunderbar. So, das ist das eine. Und dann bleibt mir jetzt am Ende noch übrig, allen Dank zu sagen, die da mitgemacht haben. Also das sind zuallererst mal die ganz vielen Teilgebenden, die da mitgemacht haben. Danke, ohne euch hätte das ja nie funktionieren können. Dann einen ganz herzlichen Dank an die 8 Unternehmen, die die Wochen gestaltet haben. Das war am Anfang die Deutsche Bahn, das war Swisscom, das war der ÖAMTC, das war Festo, Miele, SIG, SAP und jetzt Adidas. Und Sie alle haben diesen MOOC ja überhaupt erst erschaffen. Wenn die Teilnehmer nicht da gewesen wären, wäre es ins Leere gelaufen. Und wenn die Unternehmen das nicht vorher irgendwie angeregt hätten, wäre das auch nicht gelaufen. So, und dann noch ein ganz schönes Dank, großes Dankeschön natürlich an die Fachhochschule Lübeck, die uns nicht nur die Plattform zur Verfügung gestellt hat, sondern wir haben von der FH Lübeck auch eine Menge Unterstützung bekommen. Sie sind sehr erfahren im Durchführen von MOOCs und da haben wir auch von profitiert und Sie haben uns auch bei einigen Videos noch Unterstützung gegeben. Ja, herzlichen Dank. Ja, und dann natürlich der Stifterverband und die Vereinigung der Hessischen Unternehmerverbände. Auch denen haben wir Dank zu sagen, dass dieser MOOC überhaupt stattgefunden hat. Und natürlich den Paten der Corporate Learning Alliance, also den Mitgliedern der CLA. Damit glaube ich,
überziehen wir nicht mehr als notwendig.
Ja, offiziell jetzt den MOOC beschließen nach 8 Wochen. Danke an alle Beteiligten.
Und viel Spaß noch heute hier.